So for the third part of our video, what we want to do is discuss combining two functions or more together using different operations. If you'll notice this list down to the left in multicolors, f plus g of x, so we could add functions together, f minus g of x, we subtract functions, f times g of x, and f divided by g of x. So how do we handle that? And I think in a lot of ways, intuition kind of takes over here. By definition, f plus g of x is really just f of x plus g of x. And all that really means is you write down your f of x, which I define for you for this particular problem as 2x minus 1, plus your g of x is 3x minus 1, oh, 4, I read that wrong. And in this case, you combine like terms. So 2x plus 3x is 5x, and negative 1 plus a negative 4 is negative 5. And then I ask you for the domain. Well, if you'll remember from the last two videos, this is a polynomial function, and each of these are separate polynomial functions. So that means the domain is negative infinity to infinity. So this is the answer to f plus g of x, 5x minus 5, and negative infinity to infinity is the domain of f of x, of f plus g of x, which is 5x minus 5. All right, let's try a second problem that deals with subtraction. So if we want to subtract functions, this is notation read f minus g of x. By definition, that is f of x minus g of x. Simple enough, right? Which means we take the function they told us was f of x, which is 2x minus 1, minus the function they told us was g of x. Now, subtracting has an extra issue. Okay, because when we added this whole function 3x minus 4, and we could have used parentheses there or not because we're adding, but when we're subtracting 3x minus 4, those parentheses are absolutely required. And you ask why? It's because we're subtracting the entire function, not just the 3x, we're subtracting 3x minus 4, which means we need to distribute. This is 2x minus 1 minus 3x plus 4. Had you not had those parentheses there, you would have had a minus 4 still, and you would get it wrong. Now, to continue like terms, 2x subtract 3x is negative 1x or negative x, and negative 1 plus 4 is plus 3. Once again, when you take a polynomial and subtract another polynomial from it, you still get in a polynomial, so the domain is all real numbers or negative infinity to infinity. All right, this third case down here in purple, we have multiplication. That's read f times g of x. Now, by formal definition, that is f of x times g of x. So that's all we're doing, which means I want to write down f of x first, which is defined to be 2x minus 1. Now, if I'm going to multiply these things together, I need parentheses to discern the two different functions. Not only that, to show that it's multiplication. Now, depending on what type of functions you have is what you do next. When you have a polynomial times a polynomial, you do use the distributive property. So that gives me 2x times 3x is 6x squared. Y'all know this is the FOIL method. 2x times negative 4 is negative 8x. And then inside, okay, so that was first, outer, I for FOIL is inside, negative 3x, and then negative 1 times negative 4 is plus 4. I write this down with like terms combined, so the negative 8x combines with the negative 3x to give us a negative 11x plus 4. Now this is as simple as that expression gets, so this is the answer to f times g of x. It's also a polynomial. When you take a polynomial times another polynomial, you get a brand new polynomial, so the domain is negative infinity to infinity. So it turns out, as far as domain goes, whenever you add, subtract, or multiply polynomials together, you get another polynomial, so the domain would be all real numbers for each of those. Okay? And then you just have to be careful with your math when you're adding. Nothing to worry about, but just add like terms. When you're subtracting, you must distribute that minus sign inside. When you're multiplying, you'll use the distributive property. to FOIL or expand, depending on how many terms you have. Now, finally, we're dividing this last example at the bottom. By definition, this is really just f of x divided by g of x. And then you write down what you have. So f of x goes in the numerator, 2x minus 1. G of x goes in the denominator, 3x minus 4. You would simplify that if possible, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you this does not simplify. Careful, you cannot cancel this x and this x. Okay, that's not the way this works. A lot of teachers like to say that these terms are married. They're two separate terms with a subtraction in the middle. But the thing is, you can't break them apart without whatever you're canceling being in the denominator of both of them. So basically, this x and this x are not common factors because x is not a factor of this whole polynomial. X is just a factor of the 2x, not of the 1. So this is as simple as this gets. Okay? Now, the domain is not all real numbers like it was in the previous three problems because you have a variable in the denominator. So you remember what you do? You set the denominator to equal or not equal to 0, however you want to think about it. You solve by adding 4 to the other side and then dividing by 3, so x cannot be 4/3. That is your domain, but you have to write it in interval notation. So what we like to do is put it on the number line. Here's 4/3. X can't be that, but it can be everything else. So the domain for the fourth one only, is negative infinity to 4/3 with a parenthesis because it's not included, union 4/3 to infinity. All right, let's try this again with two different functions. So this time I have f of x is x squared minus 9, and g of x is x plus 3. Now notice these are both polynomials again. We don't have any variables in the denominator to deal with. We don't have any square roots or cube roots. So this is a polynomial plus a polynomial, which, remember, the domain of that is all real numbers, but let's do the calculation first. So this tells me I can just write down f of x, which is x squared minus 9, and add that to g of x, which is x plus 3. And then I combine like terms. So x squared doesn't have a like term, so I just get x squared. I always put these in descending order, so I would write x next. It does not have a like term, so I'll put plus x. And then negative 9 plus 3 is minus 6. So that is f plus g of x. The domain, because this is a polynomial, is negative infinity to infinity. Okay, next, my red graph. Let's subtract. Now remember, what's important about subtraction is you have to have parentheses. Like for addition, they're not required, but it doesn't hurt to put parentheses around the second term. Subtraction, it's absolutely required. It says f of x comes first, which is x squared minus 9, minus g of x, which is x plus 3. So trust me here, if you don't put the parentheses, you're going to miss it. Because what happens is this negative distributes. So I still have x squared minus 9 to start with, but now this is minus x minus 3. And then when I combine like terms together, that gives me x squared minus x, and then a negative 9 added to a negative 3 is a negative 12. So that is f minus g of x. That is a polynomial, so the domain is negative infinity to infinity. Third example, we're multiplying. So by definition, that is f of x times g of x. So I write down f of x, which is x squared minus 9, times g of x, which is x plus 3. Again, when you multiply polynomial times polynomial, you FOIL. So x squared times x is x to the third. X squared times 3 is 3x squared. Negative 9 times x is negative 9x. And negative 9 times a positive 3 is negative 27. The next step is you would combine like terms, but notice there's not any. I got a third, a squared, an x to the first, and a constant. So this is my final result. X to the third plus 3x squared minus 9x minus 27, which is a polynomial. So automatically, now my domain is negative infinity to infinity. All right, for my last one, which is always the issue. The division is always the problem, subtraction and division. All right, so division, I put my f of x in the numerator, which is x squared minus 9, and that's because it's listed in on top here, divided by denominator x plus 3. Then you're supposed to simplify this if possible. Now remember the last page that we had, we couldn't cancel, like I still can't cancel this one of these x's with one of these x's. You can't cancel part of subtraction or addition. But what we can do is factor this numerator. If you'll remember from a previous video, this is called a difference of squares. So what happens when you have a difference of squares is, first of all, one's plus and one's minus. Then you take the square root of x squared, or the first one, and that goes in the first spot. So the square root of the first term goes in the first spot. The square root of the second term, which is 3, goes in the second spot. So 3 and 3, and that's still divided by what's down there, x plus 3. Now, those cancel because these are factors. I canceled an entire addition with another addition in the bottom. So that gives me a final answer of x minus 3. Now, I know you're thinking that's a polynomial. It is, but when you find the domain, you have to go back to the original function to find domain. You can't look at the simplified one. It has to be back to the original function. So what I'm going to have to do here is when I look at this original function, x plus 3 was not allowed to be 0 because it was in the variable in the denominator. So x is not allowed to be negative 3 when I subtract the 3 over. So if I think about that on a number line, here's negative 3. It can't be that. It can be everything else. So we're talking negative infinity to negative 3, union negative 3 to infinity. Okay? So even though my final answer is a polynomial function, I'm still not allowed to plug negative 3 in because our original unsimplified function does not have negative 3 in the domain. It will give us a 0 in the denominator, so that part's not allowed. So you have to be careful with the division. Division can be a little bit of an issue. All right, so here I go. I have two more problems for you with two brand new functions. So in green, I have f plus g of x. All right, so now we've done a couple problems with f plus g of x. That's not a big deal, right? I've got f of x is 2 over x plus 3. Plus g of x is 1 over x minus 2. Now suddenly this doesn't look as nice and neat as our last two problems. You know why? They're not polynomials. So to combine these together, and yes, you're supposed to combine these together, we need a common denominator. And so what I'm going to have to do is my common denominator is going to be x plus 3 times x minus 2. So to make this x plus 3 times x minus 2, I need to multiply by x minus 2 over x minus 2. To make the second fraction have a denominator of x plus 3 times x minus 2, it's missing the x plus 3. So I'll multiply by x plus 3 over x plus 3. Okay. Now, underneath, that's going to give me... Now, when I multiply these two together, I need to distribute. So 2 times x minus 2 is 2x minus 4. Notice I multiplied both of them by 2. The denominator, there's no need to distribute those. Okay. Leave them factored. Plus, here I distribute and I still get x plus 3 over, again, leave denominators factored. Common denominators factored are happy that way. No need to multiply them out. But you have to multiply the numerator. Now I have a common denominator, so I'm going to add like terms. 2x plus x is 3x. Negative 4 plus 3 is negative 1. And in the denominator, I'm going to do x minus 2 times x plus 3. So that does not simplify. I can't cancel one of these x's with one of that. You know how this works. These guys are married up here, and you can't cancel part of it. Now the domain. Okay. Remember, the domain is the denominator can't equal 0, which means x cannot equal 2 from this factor, and x cannot equal negative 3 from this factor. So if you look at that on the number line, here's negative 3, here's 2. X can't be that guy or that guy. It can be everything beyond and in between, which means we're talking about a domain of negative infinity to negative 3, union negative 3 to 2, union 2 to infinity. So the domain for this problem was not as simple as the other two pages of problems we've done because we weren't dealing with polynomials. we were dealing with what we call rational functions, and you have a variable in the denominator. So that complicates things just a little bit. But we do algebra that you learned from previous classes, or come see me if you're having a lot of trouble with this adding with fractions, and then using our rules for domain to calculate the domain. Okay, so our next problem, and I hope we have enough space on here to do this, f divided by g of x just basically means you write f of x in the numerator, which is 2 over x plus 3, divided by g of x in the denominator, which is 1 over x minus 2. Now notice, this is what we call a complex fraction. It's a fraction within another fraction. But if you'll pay attention, I made this fraction bar longer. Because if I think about that, that's my original fraction. That's the fraction in f divided by g. Okay, now, here's the thing. Whenever you have a fraction, which is 2 over x plus 3 in this case, divided by another fraction, which is 1 over x minus 2, as long as those are single fractions, and they are, then what you do is you invert your denominator and multiply. That's how you divide fractions. You flip the denominator, multiply by the reciprocal is what that's really formally called. There we go. And then you simplify if possible. Now again, I know you can cancel when you're multiplying fractions. You can cancel across a denominator and numerator. But here's the deal. I can't cancel this x and this x, right? Because I can't cancel part of an x plus 3 or part of an x minus 2. Those guys are married, so addition and subtraction don't cancel part of that. It's not allowed. I could cancel an x plus 3 with another x plus 3, and that's it. All right? So, to finish this thing up then, I distribute the 2 inside. That gives me 2x minus 4. I distribute the 1 inside over x plus 3, and I'm finished with the division part. Okay, but now we've got to get the domain, and this domain is one of the more challenging. I'm going to do it in red so we can keep up with what's going on. I want you to think about this. There's three separate denominators going on here. Okay, so the first denominator that I'm looking at is x plus 3. So here's what I know is that x plus 3 better not be 0. If it is, I got a problem. Second thing I know is x minus 2. Can't be 0. So I set x minus 2 to not equal to 0. If it were 0, I would have a problem. Okay? But there's another fraction. Remember the overall big fraction? That denominator, 1 over x minus 2, can't equal to 0 either. So over here on the far left, I know this is confusing, but everything in red is 1, is me calculating the domain. That cannot equal to 0 either. So let's do the easier ones first. I'm going to subtract 3. So x cannot be negative 3. I'm going to add 2, so x cannot be 2. Then I'm going to move over here to the far left, okay, where I have 1 over x minus 2 is not equal to 0. Remember, to multiply, to solve for a variable in the denominator, you got to get it out of the denominator, which means my next step is to multiply both sides of this equation by the denominator, x minus 2 here, x minus 2 here. Those cancel, and I get 1 is not equal to 0 times x minus 2 is 0. And then you go, oh no, I don't have any x's left. So what in the world has happened? Well, then you get a false statement. So that means there is no solution to this one. There is no way that you could plug in any number to make this whole thing equal to 0. There's no number that you could plug in for this x right here to make 1 over x minus 2, 0. So I didn't get any solutions for this part. But don't forget, I did get solutions over here on the far right. X cannot be negative 3 and x cannot be 2. So if I put that on a number line, can't be negative 3, can't be 2. Well, what can it be? Everything else, right? So the domain for our second question is negative infinity to negative 3, union negative 3 to 2, union 2 to 2 infinity. Okay, now I'm going to come back for a fourth video after this to show you how to find the composite of functions.